Hey, Cinephile, this one's for you. Your love of film allows us to do what we do. If you want to support us, the best way to do so is to hit that subscribe button. From Spotify to Apple to our video versions on YouTube, subscribing matters. Feel really compelled? Well, we want to hear from you. Have a burning question? An indie filmmaker we need to interview or a film we need to know about? Think you can make us laugh on the air? Drop us a comment or a review.
Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome to another Fandor video podcast. What's up? I'm Hooman. I'm here with the great Chris Kelly.
Hey, I'm
Chris. You barely made it today.
I made it.
How busy are you?
Yeah, I'm pretty busy.
Well, where'd you come from?
I came from San Francisco. I was up at the Alchemy offices.
Oh, look at that.
Yeah, he's busy running companies like Hooli over there.
Chris is big in crypto, everybody. And blockchain.
I got some interesting things going on.
And the great Bryn.
Woohoo! And Bryn, of course,
is the most important.
All right, you guys.
It all work.
This is one of the times where I'm just over the moon excited. We got Mikey Corker and Taz Knight of the film Savage Waters. Welcome, Savage gentlemen.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
Oh, of course. It is an honor. I just want to begin by saying, Mikey, your film is excellent. It's not just good. It is so good. I mean, I really want to dive into it on a deeper level, but I just want you to know that you should be very proud of what you made. Really, like, you seem like a humble guy, but you made one hell of a movie.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate those kind words.
I rarely say that, just so you know. Okay, so tell us what your film's about.
Well, it's about a bunch of hardy adventurers heading off into the Atlantic Ocean on the hunt for a mythical wave written about in a treasure hunter's journal that was published in 1892, I think it was. But that's, the film is really about the adversity that everybody faces along the way, though. I would say the heart of the story is about the problems that arise and how everybody deals with it, because it was a mission and a voyage fraught with many sort of obstacles along the way.
So real quickly, you guys, in this book that I guess is a treasure hunting book, the captain describes in 3 pages a wave. This one wave, this like rogue wave. Mm. And like all these guys read about this wave and they're like, what? We got to find this wave and surf this wave. Uh-huh. The guy dedicates 3 pages of this novel to like this rogue, badass, incredible wave. And then these dudes are salivating and they're like, we're going to find this wave. Is that right, Mikey?
That's a good summary.
Okay, Mikey, what was the hardest thing to shoot? The hardest moment? And just let us feel it.
Good question. there were many challenges, actually. To be honest, I think as soon as you bring electronic goods onto a boat, you're opening yourself up to a fair amount of challenge as a filmmaker. But in terms of subject matter, anything around trying to capture waves or big waves is tough because they're unpredictable.
So they're on this sailboat and it's not very big at all. And you never see Mikey in the movie. You just don't see him. He's invisible the whole time. And there's just like storms. And how do you keep the camera steady enough to make the footage worthwhile? How did you do that?
Was it steady?
Yeah, it was. It worked. I mean, it could have been a lot worse.
Well, I've learned how to kind of wedge myself into corners of the boat. You got to use yourself as your own tripod. So this film was mostly shot handheld on the boat, and I like shooting off a shoulder rig. And basically, I'd always have one hand on something. You always have to be holding something to sort of help you not fall around when the boat's moving.
Yeah.
So I've just basically worked out these little methods to kind of keep myself stable and not fall over while shooting on a moving boat. And then the other tool which I used a fair bit was a monopod. And I would just wedge it into whatever, you know, just pop it up against things and just give it some stability on the boat.
Yeah.
As best I could. But actually what I found was the least things attached to the camera, like monopods, tripods, gimbals, the better, because you're just getting in and out of tiny little doorways. Everything's moving. The kind of less is more.
Wow. Okay. All right. Well, let's bring Taz Knight into the conversation here.
Hey, Taz.
Hey, Taz.
How's it going?
Taz is the surfer who surfs the wave that they finally get to. But there's a few other guys. Taz, first of all, how did you get your name? Is that your birth name?
Taz actually isn't my birth name. My birth name is Tasman. But I just called me Taz. But Tasman is the, I think he was a Dutch explorer and he discovered Australia and New Zealand. And so there's a sea called the Tasman Sea that's the strait between Australia and New Zealand. Yeah, and Tasmania and stuff like that. And so my parents were sailing around the world with my two older sisters and I was a baby in the womb. And as we were crossing the Tasman Sea, there was a pretty violent storm and I think there was a lot of praying going on to sea gods, and the promise was made to the Tasman Sea that if I wasn't born at sea, that I'd be named Tasman. So there it is.
Nice. And tell everyone what you do for a living when you're not surfing.
At the moment, I'm renovating a rundown house in Bundoran in Ireland, and then doing a whole load of other odd jobs.
I thought you were a plumber.
Coffee is the plumber.
Okay.
But I also do a lot of plumbing.
Sorry, there's so many people. We keep everyone straight. Sorry. All right. So you're not the plumber. All right. Let's go.
I have recently plumbed two bathrooms, so I'm kind of a plumber at the moment.
Oh, okay. Well, there you go. So I wasn't that off. Okay. Taz, don't say anything. Mikey, don't say anything. Chris, don't say anything. This film is narrated by Charles Dance. Bryn, who's Charles Dance?
I don't know.
Come on, you do.
I do.
He is Peter Dinklage's dad in Game of Thrones.
Oh, he gets sat on the toilet.
That's the guy.
Oh no, I love that guy.
That guy narrates it, and his voice is so perfect because all of a sudden you're taken to like this Shakespearean experience. Where they're showing these waves, and then you feel the captain of the ship speaking. It's so good. All right, how'd you get Charles Dance?
if I was going to be really blunt, we had to pay a lot of money.
All right. Well,
all right.
That works too.
But listen, and he played hardball. I fell in love with his voice. I felt straight away, like when we were kind of shortlisting who we felt which voices would work for me, it was just like his voice just stood out as the one we had to have, and it just became like it sort of became a game of cat and mouse in the negotiation, and he wasn't like, for him he was just like, here's my prize, take it or leave it. And you know, I think I remember I was offering to like do services for him and take out his bin or something. I don't know, whatever. Whatever you needed, but there was no...
or a house renovated, right?
A house renovation, driving around. I can't remember. We were offering everything, but at the end of the day, it just came down to straight up money.
Was other people on that short list? Was it like Patrick Stewart and anybody else? That you can you say who else was on the short list?
Engage.
Or no?
Who else was it? Hiddleston, Cumberbatch.
That would have been good too. No, Charles Dance was the right one. Yeah. It doesn't really matter. That you made the right choice. Okay, I'm gonna admit something to you guys. Uh-oh. I watched an hour of this movie and I stopped. And the reason I stopped is because I'm a filmmaker too, and this film deserves to be seen in the theater. It just does. And on your laptop, it's fine. It's great still. But I want the full bit. I want to feel the waves crashing on me. You know what I mean? I want to feel that sound. Mm. And so I really hope and pray that you guys have one IMAX experience with this movie or some humongous, like, is that in the works, Mikey?
It isn't. But now that you say that, that would be amazing.
How can you not? You're sitting. Am I right, Taz? Do you want to say something, Taz?
You know what? Can I say something? Taz hasn't seen the film yet.
Oh my God!
There we go.
I haven't seen a single clip. Nothing. While we were filming, when you're at sea, you can't take like SD cards out of cameras. It goes straight on the hard drives and it gets locked away in a Tupperware. You can't risk losing it.
What's your guys' problem about the Tupperware?
Yeah, tell us about the Tupperware.
Tupperware is critical.
It goes into a sturdy hard drive vault called a Tupperware.
All right, hold on. Taz and Mikey, how far do you guys live from each other?
Well, I'm in North Devon at the moment, but Taz actually, their family home and where I met Taz is, they live, their family house is really close to me, like 5 minute drive.
Mikey, can you just send Taz 5 minutes of the movie when we hang up? So like, when this interview is done, let him see something.
We've got a special screening for Taz and the rest of his family. I can't say too much about it, but it's a little like a little private screening.
All right.
And it's on a big screen. We also didn't want to give them the laptop experience. The family's been so amazing with us and with me just accommodating, you know, my kind of prying lens for so many years that we thought it'd be a nice way to say thank you. So before we start the official premiere kind of and film festival circuit, we wanna just show the family the film on a big screen.
So listen, Taz. First of all, I just want to say your dad is great on camera. I just couldn't get enough of that guy. So, and the fact that you guys do that as a family is so beautiful. I just hope that you realize how blessed you are, bro, because you just got the very best kind of family history footage that anybody's ever gotten. Like, this is something that can go for 500 years in your family and be like, oh, this is our great, 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 great grandfather. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, I've always been super blessed at like our family life. We had an amazing time. I mean, it was just mum and dad just always had this way of living their life where they'd just go off and we'd hang out and sail around and live in buses and live in caravans. And we've just always had an amazing time as a family. And I think when you spend a lot of time living in really tight, closed spaces with each other, you just get really close. So we spent years and years, just all six of us, living in little buses and little caravans and little boats. And so we're all super close, even to this day. You know, we're a really, really tight family. It's amazing.
That's great.
So this film is part of Doclands, which is part of the Mill Valley Film Festival. I'm going to ask you a question that I should have asked the PR person, and I hope you have the answer. Do you know what day and time your movie is screening at Doclands?
Yeah, it's on the 5th at, I could be wrong, but I think 7 p.m.
Okay, listen to the sound of my voice, people.
Shelly's nodding. She says yes.
This is the movie.
Always good to get that right.
Everyone go see this movie in person. Do yourselves a favor. It's worth it. It's 2 hours where you're just gonna forget, you know, about the pandemic. You're gonna forget about political divisions, and this movie's just gonna suck you in. It's so good. All right, Mikey. So what do you want people to walk away with after seeing this movie?
I think you've sort of summed it up there. I think I would like people to feel a little inspired. I want people to kind of look at what's blocking them in their own lives, any kind of fears or anything, and just, you know, take a little punt, take a bit of a gamble on themselves, and just realize that we've only got one opportunity in this life. So give it your best shot.
Nice.
All right, listen, we want to talk to Taz for a little bit. Taz, Bryn and I surf and we suck, okay?
Like, hey, speak for yourself.
I have surfed.
Oh, you
and,
have?
And I do suck.
Okay, great. All right, great. So no, Chris I'm and kidding. I suck I'm and Bryn's bad. Amazing. Yeah. But when you, are you able to judge which waves to say yes to and which one? How long does it take before your eyes can adjust to what to surf
what
and what
to catch,
yeah
right?
Help us
yeah.
out here with this.
Yeah, well, so obviously you guys have tried surfing, and that's, you know, the hardest thing in surfing. That's probably why you brought it up, is it's wave selection and identifying which wave to catch. And that's why surfing takes longer than any other sport to learn how to do, because every single wave that comes in is different. Yeah. So it just takes years and years.
Years and years. So we just have to stay in the water, is what you're saying. So
just, yeah, it's the sort of thing that you can't teach, you can't learn it. It's just time, and you just have to see every single possible different wave that comes through 100 times. And then once you've seen it 100 times, you'll recognize it the next time it comes.
I hope you have an answer to this, because then if not, it's going to be another plumber mention. what's your worst injury in surfing?
I've had a load of injuries surfing, mainly knee injuries. I've actually had 3 surgeries in my right knee trying to fix it. The worst one was I just wear a knee brace now all the time.
What's the worst one? What's
the worst but one? The worst one was just a full MCL tear that went through to the ACL and the bucket handle tear in the meniscus, so my knee just sort of went like that.
That's not good.
That's bad.
Did you feel it right away?
Yeah, I mean, your leg just locks up because the cartilage is flopping around. It gets stuck in the joint of your knee. So,
ouch.
Yeah, that sounds like it's pretty brutal.
Ouch.
Actually, while we were filming Savage Waters, the very final trip we did, I blew my cartilage again and had another bucket handle tear in my cartilage. That's kind of what ended the filming for me, was the end of that movie.
Oh, man.
Well, their names are Taz Knight, one of the surfers in the movie, Mikey Corker, the director. Once again, gentlemen, you did it. You really knocked it out of the park. Congratulations on your film. Everyone, go to Doclands. Check out the Mill Valley Film Festival website. And if you can, go in person. Remind us the day and time one more time, Mikey.
It's Thursday, 5th of May, 7 p.m. at the Doclands Film Festival world premiere.
It's
world premiere.
It's a world's premiere, everyone. Please be there for the world's premiere. All right, gentlemen, we wish you nothing but the best.
Catch away.
Thank you so much.